Dams are some of the most marvelous structures mankind has ever built. But how do they hold back entire lakes? In this video, we dive deeper into the hydrostatic forces exerted on a dam and the mechanism by which the dams withstand these forces. To understand how a dam works, we need to understand what hydrostatic forces are. Hydrostatic forces are loads that fluids at rest exert on their containers, which in this case is the dam and the surrounding terrain. One easy way to understand the origin of the hydrostatic forces is to investigate the interactions within the body of water. Let's model the water in a dam as tiny blocks of water. Due to gravity, the weight of the upper block presses down on the lower block, which tries to relieve the pressure by displacing away. If there's no side pressure, then the water will spread out until an equilibrium is reached. However, in our case, one side is supported by the dam. This means that the dam needs to absorb the pressure. This side pressure depends on how hard the water is pressed or squeezed. If we add more water on top, then the additional weight presses harder on the bottom block, which increases the side pressure. This is well illustrated with a barrel with holes along its height. The water stream coming off of the lower holes will reach further away compared to the water stream coming off of the upper holes. Since dams can be extremely tall, the hydrostatic pressure at the base of the dam can also be extremely large. This triangular pressure diagram is the main force that the dam needs to resist. Gravity loads are the main consideration for dams, so that's what we'll focus on here. But keep in mind that there are also load considerations such as earthquakes. If you want to get an idea how earthquake loads act, check out our video on that. Now that we have an understanding of the main load which dams feel, we can start thinking of a suitable structure to resist it. Let's start with the most basic structure, a concrete block, and iterate to something more efficient. Obviously, this structure is not very efficient. We have equal amount of material along the entire height, but unequal load distribution. Tapering the structure would be a more efficient use of the material. This way, the higher loads are met with more material and vice versa for the lower loads near the tip of the dam. We can go a step further and curve the structure. This way, we can eliminate or at least reduce tension loads and engage more of the dam in compression with arching behavior. From one of our previous videos, we saw that concrete is superior in resisting compression forces when built into arches. And already, we have an extremely efficient structure that starts to look a lot like some iconic dams from the real world. One problem with arches is that they produce large thrust forces that the dam will need to resist, and therefore the surrounding valley as well. Thrust forces are horizontal forces that keep arches compressed. These forces originate at the center of the arch and keep each half in compression, before being resisted at the either end of the arch. Therefore, a requirement for an arch dam is a solid rock foundation that can absorb the large thrust forces. But clearly, not all dams take an arch shape. If the arch is the most efficient shape, then why do we have dams like the Three-Gorges Dam that maintains a straight line across its valley? The explanation to this lies in the shape of the valley. Narrower valleys are more suitable for arch dams. The valley of the Three-Gorges Dam is 2.3 kilometers long. So if this structure took the shape of an arch with the same height to width ratio as the Hoover Dam, then the structure would have been almost 500 meters longer than what it is now. Instead of making a longer curved structure, the Three-Gorges Dam takes a more massive, straight shape. Straight dams also have their own advantages. They are easier to construct and do not necessarily need solid rock foundations as arches do, because they use a different mechanism to transfer the hydrostatic loads. These dams are also known as gravity dams because they use their massive weight to produce large enough friction forces to hold back the water reservoir. Due to their massive size, these structures usually do not suffer from high internal stresses. The governing failure mode comes down to the sliding resistance between the dam and the ground beneath it. Often, gravity dams incorporate a shear key which helps generate a larger resistance to sliding. As an example, we made a low detail model of the Three-Gorges Dam and analyzed it under hydrostatic forces. As seen on the model, the maximum stress in the monolith is way below the yield stress of concrete. But keep in mind, this model is way oversimplified and an actual design is much more rigorous and takes hundreds of man hours to design against all possible failure modes.
Failure modes can be intuitive, like the entire dam overtopping or sliding at the base, or the concrete failing structurally. But there are also some less intuitive failure modes, which are very relevant, such as seepage or seismic failures. One example of these concerns is the Mullaperiyar Dam in India. So there is a very high chance that I'm mispronouncing the name, so please forgive us for that. The dam was built more than 125 years ago. Construction materials and engineering practices have changed a lot since then. As you can see on this cross-section, the dam was constructed using uncoursed rubble masonry, in essence, randomly sized and randomly placed stone, and cirque mortar, which is basically brick powder, lime, and water. During the 1980s, concrete was also added to the downstream side to strengthen the old structure, but the upstream water could not be drained to perform a full restoration. Today, the dam is experiencing seepage issues, where water under high pressure seeps through small cracks in the structure and carries out the cirque mortar with it. Over time, this removes material, and thus strength, from the core of the dam, which can lead to failure. Additionally, the dam is known to be in an earthquake-prone area without being designed as such. Thanks for watching another video of the Engineering Hub. Making these videos takes a lot of time, and if you enjoy them, you can consider supporting us by getting us a coffee through the Buy Me a Coffee website. You can find the link in the description. But of course, we understand that it is a difficult period, so don't feel pressured to do so. You can also support us by subscribing to our channel, which doesn't cost anything. And of course, we would love to hear from you in the comments. Please let us know how we did and if there is something we could improve.